call him Jesus.
My rock.
you, Jesus. Amen and amen. Thank you, Lord God. I give you praise and glory. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Amen and amen. Praise God. While we're standing tonight, let's take advantage of the fact that we can come before the Lord with confidence. If you have needs tonight, if you have things in your life right now that God, you know that God can needs to be given attention, I'm going to encourage you to do that right now in Jesus' name. Why don't we just do this by the closing of our eyes and the lifting of our hands? Let's just join together. Let's just be together in this. Oh, Lord Jesus, I'm so thankful, Lord God, so thankful that we can come. We can come unto you, all of us that are heavy laden in labor, and we can count on you. In Jesus' name, strengthen us tonight, Lord God. I'm believing you tonight for the strength of your spirit, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. That's it. Pray with confidence that he not only hears, but he's able to do exceeding abundant above all that we ask or think. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord God, yes. Praise God, praise God, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's right. We can just thank him. Praise him. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. You, Lord God, will help us as you always do in the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. You can go ahead and be seated. The Lord bless you tonight. Again, we thank you for coming. Thank the Lord that he can help us to build our relationships, not only with him, but with each other. Praise God. What a wonderful idea. Tonight we're going to be looking at the fact that we need leaders. We need people to lead the way. And probably a good example of this, of course, is taken in the Old Testament in our text. And it has to do with the book of Nehemiah. I don't know how many of you have ever read the book of Nehemiah. I would hope and presume that all of you have. It's a tremendous book. Those 13 chapters demonstrate to me personally that God is not only a God of mercy, he's a God of restoration, he's a God of order. You know, one thing about God is he doesn't go back on the plan. You know, a lot of times he'll reestablish the plan, which is what he did during the days of Nehemiah. But one thing that we can expect is we can expect that there's going to be challenges. Amen. There's going to be challenges. Praise God. You know, somebody said there's a difference between challenges and problems. Problems are to be solved. And God will allow problems to come into our lives just for the fact that we can sooner or later know that they can be solved. Praise God. And I'm thankful for that. Challenges are a little bit different. Sometimes challenges are things that we have to recognize that are going to be there. Amen. Let me just give you an example, okay? If it be my idea, okay? Everybody look at me and say it's his idea. Okay. I'd have told the devil to take a hike. I'd have told him, you're out of here. That I'm going to work on my people and I'm going to do it without you being here. But it wasn't God's idea. God has allowed the devil to stay here. He's allowed him to run, I'm not going to say rampant, but he's allowed him to have to tempt us and things of that nature. And of course, I'm not questioning the plan of God. Don't misunderstand me. But we must understand the devil is a challenge. He's not a problem that can be solved. He's a challenge that you and I have in our life from time to time. And so this is what you and I must recognize. It's not like God is going to give him, you know, complete free rein, but he is going to give him access. And so we understand that God uses him, you know, to test us in ways and so on and so forth. And, of course, I understand, and please don't take this wrong, but I don't think there's any of us in this room that are probably going to warrant a personal visit from the devil. I just think he's got bigger fish that he wants to fry. That's just how it is, you know. But his agents are there. And we understand that his system runs all the way through this world. The Bible uses the phrase at one place that he is the God of this world. So there are certain things that he does have access to, and he's building his system. Now, I'm confident that through the help of the Lord that we can not only raise to this challenge, but we can overcome this challenge. Praise God. And so a lot of times in Scripture, that's what I think sometimes we're looking for. We're looking for God not only to help us with the problems of life, amen, but we're asking God to get rid of the challenges we have in life. And sometimes that can bring a little bit of frustration. You know, maybe there's somebody in here today that maybe God will help shine light on and help you to understand that there are some challenges in your life that God has confidence in you. Through his help, that you can rise to the occasion. Praise God. What do you say? What do you say we make kind of a pact with God and say, Leah, that's okay, God. Amen. Now, I'm going to do that in Jesus' name. And so I think the story of Nehemiah can help us with that because, you know, God could have, after that 70-year period of judgment, he could have just came and said, okay, I'm going to leave you alone for about 3 or 4 months, and I'm going to let you rebuild the city, and we'll just get everything all underway. But that's not how God did it. And so hopefully this will be a help to somebody. In Jesus' name. Another thing that we get out of the book of Nehemiah, in my opinion, is we get the fact that when people begin to work together, when people get together and begin to work together, praise God, and especially the church, these challenges, in my opinion, can be easier met. Praise God. That's why, you know, along with building our relationship with God, which I hope that you're doing on a daily basis, we need to build our relationship with God. We need to be connected to him as best as we can. Well, I hope that you will also consider on a regular basis, building relationships with the people in the church or your fellow brothers and sisters. Amen. And I believe the Lord, again, can help us with those things. You know, most of us, I wouldn't say probably any of us in this room have a problem, a real big problem with God. I think really what that stems from sometimes is lack of understanding, not knowing, you know, everything that's going on. And sometimes we can, we can find ourselves in those areas. And that's just the way it's going to be. But to have a problem with somebody that's perfect, come on. You're kind of wasting your time there, you know, to have a problem with someone who doesn't change. See, these are all attributes of the God that you and I serve. He doesn't change. He doesn't have to. He's not developing into a better God. You know, he's not going to the University of God up there someplace and he's writing his thesis on us, okay? That's not how it works. God is God. He always was, always will be. Can somebody say amen? But our biggest challenge is, I think, especially after we come to the knowledge of the Lord and we're saved and we come into the saving grace and saving knowledge, a lot of the challenges we're going to face on a regular basis is with one another, you know. And so hopefully we can gain some things here and we can help that with true leadership. And I believe that God has leadership in the world today. I really do. I believe that they're God-ordained leaders. Praise God. And I believe if we can follow that type of thing, I believe that God can help us. Nehemiah chapter number 4, verses 1 through 6. You know, the Bible teaches us something here. It says, but it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that we builded the wall, he was wroth, and he took great indignation, and he mocked the Jews. Now, Sanballat's one of those challenges in life. He is, in my opinion, a perfect type of the Antichrist. He doesn't want to see the system of God being rebuilt again. And so there's going to be Sanballats that are going to come in your life, you know. And so he was ticked. He was mad, you know. He had tried to thwart the work of that God wanted, and it didn't happen, and all of a sudden it started to come to pass, and he's getting upset, okay? Bible says, and he spoke before his brethren and the army of Samaria and said, what do these feeble Jews... You know, basically he's accusing them of being weak. He says, will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in the day? It says, will they revive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned? I'm going to presume that there's more scripture. Yep. Okay. Now, Tobiah, here's another one of our challenges. The Ammonite, it says, was by him, you know. And he said, even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall even break down the stone wall. You see what he's doing? He's making fun of what they're doing. He's saying those guys don't know what they're doing, you know. And then verse number 4, hear, O our God, for we are despised. Now, this is not Sanballat, and this is not Tobiah. This is Nehemiah. He's saying this. This is a prayer that he is praying. Hear, O our God, for we are despised, and turn their reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity. He's turning this thing around, Nehemiah. And cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before them, or before thee. For they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. It says, so build we the wall. Everybody say the wall. And all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof. It says, for the people had a mind to work, praise God. In one portion of Scripture, it says that within 52 days, they rose up that wall, praise God. People got together and said, listen, God wants this city rebuilt. He wants his kingdom established, even though it wasn't a fraction of what it was, but God's restoring, praise God. And so the people saw the vision, and they got a hold of the vision, and they went to work in Jesus' name, praise God. I'm going to tell you something, folks. I believe in that principle. I believe there's no way that you and I can ever work to get ourselves to heaven. Can somebody be in agreement with me there? You know, it took the blood of Jesus Christ. But while we are down here, praise God, I believe that God is going to challenge us to get to work for his kingdom. And part of the work of the kingdom, praise God, and I know in the physical sense here, we're talking about a city wall that was risen up for protection. Well, I believe that God wants to put a spiritual wall around you in the name of Jesus. And I believe that you can go to work with that along with your brothers and sisters, and you can begin to see some things happen in the name of Jesus. Praise God. Anybody for that? But listen to me. Don't take this anyway, but literally, praise God. Dave and I had a discussion tonight before church, and he said, how about the Bible? I said, the best way to take the Bible is literal. Take it for just, it's written to you. Listen to what God has to say. Well, listen, if you're going to get anything accomplished for the kingdom of God down here, you and I are going to have to go to work in Jesus' name. Now, listen to me. Let me give you some examples. Sometimes it's going to be work to come to church and praise. Sometimes it's going to be work when to get up and to pray when you think everything else is lost. Sometimes it's going to be work to get along with people that sometimes, you know, make that a hard situation. But how many here tonight want to be challenged to go to work and want to be committed to that in Jesus' name? Come on, why don't we just let the Lord know that right now? Come on, let's let God know that out of our own mouths, that Jesus, I mean business. Praise God. I want to rebuild. I want to restore. I want to be not only what we talked about last week. We talked about a Barnabas, but I want to be somebody who's not afraid of a little bit of work in Jesus' name. And Lord God, I believe that you can help us tonight to glean from this, something from this Bible study that will help us to initiate that in our lives in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Praise God. Somebody say, thank the Lord. Yes, thank the Lord for something to do. Praise God. Now, as we talked about tonight, the one of the big examples that we're talking about here is, of course, the book of Nehemiah. And I don't know when was the last time you read it. I actually went through the whole thing last night myself. It draws me. I love that book. I've gotten a lot of what I would call very valuable things to apply to my own personal life through the years. Every time I go through that book, there's something that stands out again and just says, listen, this is an area that you need to be working on. And so I'm not afraid of that. But it is a book that, in my opinion, gives me the confidence of God's restoration plan. Praise God. And one of the things that you're going to find right off in the book of Nehemiah is that God, again, uses a man. He uses somebody that he can get a hold of, praise God. And so I believe that's been the deal with God for all of these years, praise God, is that God is going to look for somebody like you and I that he can speak to, that can begin to receive what he wants to do, and not critique it, not get to a place where you say, well, God, if we can make these changes or anything like that, but somebody who will just listen to God and say, okay, God, I'll move forward with that. I'll move forward with whatever you want. And I believe, now personally, I believe if you're in the kingdom of God, you might not be the leader of the church, you might not be a pastor or called to a ministerial type of an office, but I believe that God will always give you initiative to go to work for his kingdom. I mean, right away. That's one thing that God helped me to understand right off the bat when I came into the church. It wasn't an idea whether I deserved this or not. God just said, listen, I want to give you something to do. And boy, I mean to tell you, when God gives you something to do, that is a privilege. We got to recognize that in Jesus' name. Okay? So the epic story of Nehemiah began when Nehemiah took the initiative, there's the word, to discover a need, praise God. You know, the news came back, the city's in rumbles. I mean, this thing really looks bad, and I mean, it's just a shameful situation. But make no mistake about it, Nehemiah was one of these guys that just said, listen, I'm not going to sit around, and I'm not just going to, you know, do nothing about it. There's something that can be done in Jesus' name. Can somebody say amen to that? I believe there's always something in the kingdom of God that can be done. Always, praise God. And I believe that God will help us. Now, in Nehemiah chapter number 1 and verse number 2, it makes that statement that he got the report from this guy here. Hanani, I think is how you pronounce that. And he was related to Nehemiah. And he came, and he and certain men of Judea, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. He's interested. He said, what's going on there? What's happening? Praise God. And sometimes I think that's a good idea. I think that this is why we need to learn how to talk to one another. Sometimes people are going to tell you what's going on in their life. And I think that's okay. I think if we're out there trying to dig up things that, you know, that just to keep ourselves busy, I think we have to be careful with that. But I think if you ever become a good listener, which I think all of us need to just keep taking that class, you know, I think sooner or later you're going to hear something, praise God, and you're going to hear something that really could use a hand. That's just part of being in the church, praise God, and that's part of God's stick it, the stick, I guess the word I'm looking for is something like cement. That's what he sticks us together. It's because it's every day, doesn't make any difference what week it is, praise God, somebody in the church is going to need somebody to help them. And I believe that we can begin to recognize that, and we can take, somebody say initiative. We can, praise God. Amen. That doesn't mean that we want them to do it our way. That just means that, hey, we recognize in the kingdom of God, there are people just like you and I who need a hand. Reach your hand over to somebody and say, I need your hand. Sure you do. Sure you do, whether you know it or not. Praise God. Amen. Amen. And so we must understand that God wants to help us. The scripture teaches us in Proverbs 25 and 28 says, he that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down. And so we're talking about a physical city. We're talking about a physical city of Jerusalem that needed to be built up. Well, in my opinion, like I said before, there are spiritual walls that need to come up in our own lives. Amen. That's why I believe that a lot of what we do in the New Testament church is in that spiritual realm. It's not that we don't help each other physically from time to time. I mean, that just goes without saying. But the bottom line is a lot of the help that people need that come to the church is in the spiritual realm. And one of the reasons they need that help is because they have no rule over them. You see, that's what a lot of our world is. A lot of our world is just kind of left to itself, you know. I'm thinking of a story in the book of Judges, the Zidonians, I believe it was. And the Zidonians were good people. They were people that, you know, kind of kept to themselves and that type of thing. And they were people that just kind of lived and went on with life. But the Bible says that there was a trait amongst them, that everybody kind of did what they felt was right in their own heart. That's what it was. And if there's anything that describes sometimes the country you and I live in, that's kind of what it is, isn't it? People just kind of do what they feel is right in their own hearts. And I'm not saying necessarily it's sinful, but usually there isn't much unity there. Usually there isn't much leadership there, praise God. And so this is why sometimes we're dealing with people that aren't, you know, they're not axe murderers, they're not horrible people, but they really don't have any rulership in their life. Are you glad that Jesus Christ restored genuine apostolic leadership into your life? I am too. No, I'm not looking for your response as much as I'm looking for your reception of that. That is sometimes we lose track of. God put true leadership in our lives, and we must recognize that. It's like the proverb says, he that hath no rule over his own spirit. You got to understand, your physical flesh can't handle a lot of things that your spirit can. But boy, once you got a spirit, the human spirit kind of is left by itself, I'm going to tell you something, you got a real problem there. And that's where, in my opinion, a lot of the crux of the matter is. But aren't you glad through the baptism of the Holy Ghost that God returns true rulership into a person's life? Amen. And that's good news, folks. Whether the world wants to hear that or not, that's good news. The scripture also tells us the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run to it. They don't run from it, they run to it, and that they're safe, praise God. You see what God wants to do? He not only wants to restore true rulership in our lives, but he wants to restore safety and order. Now, it doesn't mean that we're going to avoid all of the challenges of life. It just means that on a lot of ways, praise God, God is going to protect his people. You know, one of the things that I feel like is going to be shown to us when we get up there, amongst a lot of things, is I think what's going to be shown to us is the many, 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 many times that God helped us to avoid problems. I believe that's really going to be shown to us when we really get a glimpse of this whole thing. How many times God came to our rescue? How many times God, through following the biblical principles of the Bible, how many pathways you and I have avoided in our lives? Oh, to me, that is a comforting thought, in my opinion. That is a very comforting thought, praise God. And so the name of the Lord, and what is the name of the Lord? Jesus. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous, those that want to do it God's way, praise God. I think of in the book of Acts, when Peter finally got the full vision of what God was doing. You know, he said, I perceive that God is no respecter of persons. That anywhere, any place in the world, people that will fear him and want to do what's right, praise God, are going to be accepted of God. And I believe that's still the case today. Amen. People that want to do what's right. Amen. Jesus made that statement when he was confronted by John about baptism. Well, I need to be baptizing you. Jesus said, no. Thus we fulfill all righteousness. In my opinion, Jesus never needed to be baptized for the remission of sins because he never committed any. But he said, he's telling the world this is the right thing to do. Aren't you glad that God brings a bunch of right things into your life that you can begin to do and keep doing them in Jesus' name? Listen to me, folks. That's like a tower that you run into every day and you are safe in Jesus' name. Come on, I'm not talking about a literal tower. I'm talking about a spiritual tower that you and I can run into and we can be safe in Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so these are things that we can recognize. Now again, back to Nehemiah chapter number 1 and verse number 4, and it came to pass when I heard these things. Now Nehemiah's like a lot of us. He's talking to himself. You know, he said, and it came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and I wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Do you see what's happening here? Do you see what's happening to Nehemiah? He's not doing nothing. He's doing something about it. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be. Come on, in order to be comforted, you got to learn how to mourn. And there's some things, listen to me, folks, this is what we want in the church. We want to come to a building like this 24/7. I'm not saying you do, but probably somebody that you know. But, you know, we want to come to a building like this, and we don't want to hear about any of the problems. We just want to come in here and feel the safety and the bliss of God. And I don't think that's a bad intention, but that isn't the real world. The real world that you and I live in is fastly going to hell. And you know something? Periodically, that ought to bother us. That ought to move us into a situation where, listen, I'm not going to just stand here and let that happen. Now, I understand I can't get on the radio, I can't go to Washington, D.C., I can't go to, you know, to the United Nations, but I can get on my knees to my God. I can begin to pray. I can begin to weep between the porch and the altar, as the Old Testament says. We can always begin to do something. And this is what impresses me about Nehemiah, is that he just didn't let it be a bad report and saying, oh, well, I guess that's just the way it is. No, Nehemiah didn't accept that report that way. What he said is, listen, I'm going to do something about it, and I believe he did the right thing. He sat down, he wept, he mourned for certain days, and then he got into a regimen of fasting and praying, praise God, before who? Before his God. Come on, because you got to understand God's got solutions. God's got things that you and I, we can be doing. And if we can get ourselves into a pattern where we can hear from God on a regular basis, I believe we can be like a person like Nehemiah, and we can begin to initiate some things. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, I believe the Lord wants to give somebody a fresh vision here tonight in this Bible study about you. But when it comes to God, there's always something that can be done. Always something in His kingdom, in Jesus' name. And so think about that. Let the Lord just kind of remind you of some things maybe of the past. Now, people's needs are foremost spiritual, as we've talked about before in the book of Proverbs, that a person, you know, if the person's spirit isn't under rule, that it's like a city that's broken down, it's just susceptible to any kind of temptation that comes by. And you must understand, when we talk about our challenge, who were we talking about before? The devil. The devil is our challenge. Well, what's one of the arrows that he wants to stick into your side tonight? It's called the arrow of temptation, isn't it? Well, don't you think that God wants to begin to build walls, praise God, to where those temptations aren't quite as easy as they were? Come on, I believe that this is what God will do. And so we must understand that most people's needs, the crux of their needs, let me put it this way, can always go back to the spiritual need. People need to have the return of a ruler to their spirit. And God wants to do that. Amen. And that's why He will call people like Nehemiah's and people like you and I to help people to recognize that there's things in their life that you have tore down the city. You've tore down the walls. A lot of times people are going, why does all of this stuff happen to me? How come all of these bad things are happening to me? Well, you can help them to understand that if they would begin to live for God and allow God to build some walls into their lives and some gates, God would help them to become a gatekeeper, praise God, and they could begin to check some things out before they come into the house. Come on, folks, this is not that hard. This is a simple principle that God has for each and every one of us. Every one of us can begin and continue to do these kind of things. And I believe, again, reading a book like Nehemiah, what that does for me, I don't know about you, but it gives me a visual. It gives me a visual. I begin to see people taking hammers and saws. And you got to understand, the crew that he got together with, they weren't professional carpenters. A lot of them guys had never done that before. And so that would, you know, generate the idea that how are we ever going to get this done? Well, I'll tell you how we're going to get this done. Is first of all, we're going to get our directions from God. Because if you get your directions from God, no matter how hard the task is, God's going to help you to do it. Can you say amen? And then what we're going to do is we're going to get a bunch of people together that are of the same absolute thinking, praise God. And boy, believe me, when unity comes into the picture, come on, you got to understand, the Bible only uses the word unity 3 different times. It uses it in the unity of the faith. Somebody say faith. Come on, we can have unity of faith in here. Come on, we can do that. Praise God. And then it talks about the unity of the Spirit. Praise God. And you and I, we can do that. Amen. And then in the Old Testament, it talks about the unity of the brethren. And we can do that. Come on, I'm telling you right now, I believe a lot of the challenges in life can be met with the unity of the spirit, of the faith, and of the brethren, praise God. In fact, I believe God has given us that blueprint all many, many, many times. And so we must understand, praise God, that Nehemiah was a product of this. Now listen to what it says there in verse number 8 there. It says, remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses. Where's he going back to? Come on, what's he doing? Come on, see this, saint. See this. He's not trying to reinvent the wheel here. He's not trying to get another book out or get some kind of a what's the best seller on the market right now or what's the fad out there. No, he goes back to the book of the law. And he says, thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. Okay, let's quit blaming God for our problems. We're the ones that brought these problems on ourselves. We're the ones that transgress God. And all we are doing is we're being a recipient for what we have done. Now, come on, folks. There's a lot of people that don't know what I just told you. They think that God has brought these problems on. And you got to understand, God doesn't bring those kind of problems on. We bring those problems on. Just study the 4th chapter of the book of James. Where do the wars come from? Where do the murderings, where do the arguments, all that kind of stuff? The Bible says it comes from us. And so if we can begin to realize that, and that's what Nehemiah did. He went back to the beginning. The reason we got this problem is because of what we did. And then, look at this, good news. Look at somebody and say, good news. But if ye turn unto me, Praise God. Come on. This is a principle for the church today. If you turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out into the uttermost part of the heaven, yet will I gather. Come on. Do you see what God can do? God can begin to gather things up. It says, and gather them from thence, and I will bring them into a place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now, come on, some of you are going to miss this. How come Nehemiah got this message? Because he got bothered by the condition of his country, and he decided to do something about it. And what he did about it was not go and whine to a whole bunch of people. He got down on his knees, and he began to pray, and he began to fast, and he said, God, give me the answers here. And bam, right there, God gives him the answers. He said, this is the problem. So you got to understand, God could have came down and he could have fixed that city up just like that. But if the people weren't willing to follow God, what good does it do to build a city? What good does it do to build fortified walls? Come on, the Bible says in one place in Scripture that we labor in vain. So the first thing that's got to happen is we got to get right with God. Come on, folks, this is what God's calling us to do, and you are people that are positioned in that every day. You can be right with God every day. Come on, I'm not saying that you're better than anybody else, but you got a hold of the things of the Lord. Come on, let God help you to be a righteous person, and I'll guarantee you, you're going to be a home builder. You're going to be a wall builder. You're going to be a gate replacer, praise God. God's going to help you to do the things that he wants. Am I the only one that's getting this? Am I the only one? Is this too exciting for Wednesday nights? Is this okay? Come on, you're over in the cheap seats. How are we doing? Okay, didn't charge you much for them, okay? That's what I'm saying. Come on, am I the only one that's getting this? And I'm not expecting you to do loop-de-loops or run the aisles, but folks, I'm going to tell you something. A smile and a nod once in a while would help. Oh, is that? I wore it on purpose. I knew this was going to be a hard crew, you know. I mean, I've got to get these guys to laugh or something. Oh, folks, the book of Nehemiah is a message of hope. You got to understand, I wasn't there, but I'm a visual. I can see that city was laid in ruins, that they knocked down that beautiful temple that Solomon had built. And I mean, everything was in shambles. It didn't look good for the home team. But here's a man that says, wait a minute, I'm bothered by that. God wants to do something, and I'm not really sure what he wants to do yet. And so he gets on his face, and he begins to fast and pray, and he begins to get direction from God. Doesn't that sound like the way it should be? Now, what's wrong with us? How come we go days and days and sometimes week without checking in on God? I'm just asking. You see, that should be the first thing that we do. Every day, you and I ought to be a Nehemiah, and we ought to be a little bothered by the world we're living in. Come on, I'm not talking about losing sleep. I'm not talking about becoming a neurotic. I'm just talking about we ought to be a little bothered by the people that we see on the street that just seem to go nonchalant without God. And I believe that the Lord can help us to begin to obtain a burden. And then along with that burden, he'll help us to lift that burden and to do the things that he wants us to do. Can you say amen? The problem with Wednesday nights is I never have enough time. Okay, that's a challenge. That's a challenge. Okay, where are we at? I better move forward here, okay? Okay, God has positioned each of us to minister in a particular way. I want to really emphasize that tonight. Amen. I talked about this Sunday night. Remember when we talked about the anointings of the Lord? One of those anointings that God wants to put on us is the anointing of ministering, that we can minister to the Lord. And I believe that, boy, there's going to be a lot of things that are going to happen. So all of us, you know, he has positioned us in a place, praise God, where we can make that difference. And amen, just like Nehemiah, we can make a huge difference in Jesus' name. Nehemiah 2 and 2, now they're getting with the program. It says, wherefore the king said, because you got to understand, God knew where Nehemiah was at. Does anybody know what Nehemiah was? What was his job? You know what it was? He was a cupbearer. You want a drink, king? I'd love to have a job like that. I don't know what it pays. I mean, my goodness, it'd be a whole lot easier than fixing that bass clarinet I did the other day. My goodness, your cup empty here? I can feel that. That's what he was. But even more so, do you want to know what Nehemiah was? He was a servant. He was a servant. And so I believe that went a long way with him. And so he had access to the king. He was right there in the throne room. You talk about having influence, he did, just being there. And so the Bible says, wherefore the king said unto me, why is thy countenance sad? And you got to understand, I heard this. I haven't been able to verify it in scripture, but they say that was a no-no. That's one of the things the kings demanded, that everybody that was in the throne room, they had to have a smile on their face. They couldn't be in a bad mood. Ooh, that'd disqualify a lot of us, wouldn't it? Well, I haven't had my morning coffee yet, King. You know, he's tough. You're out of here, man. I got somebody that does, you know. But the bottom line is the king saw him with a sad countenance, and he was taking a chance. Nehemiah could have lost his job because of that. But the Bible says, you know, that seeing that thou art not sick, this is nothing else but sorrow of heart. And then I was very sore afraid. And what happens is, you know, like a true leader, Nehemiah knew it was not all about him. But undue haste or lack of planning would likely cause this project to fail. What was the deal here? The deal was he was going to get the king's backing. And where do you think he got that idea from? Think he read that in the morning newspaper? No, I think he probably got that on one of his morning devotions. That God said, I'm going to set you up, buddy, and you're going to be able to get this thing financed. Because you got to understand, without the king's permission, they weren't going to go anywhere and restore a city. And so you see what God was doing here, how he very intricately, you know, brought these factors all together. And people begin to listen to him. And I'll tell you something, I thank God for people who will see what needs to get done and not wait 2 or 3 months, but will begin to do it. And listen to me, I know this is, I've been saying a lot and been dancing around this all night, but the bottom line is, folks, you know, I think there's always a time when we can pray and we can fast and we can get the mind of God. And I believe a lot of times that's where this is all going to become initiated at, is through the power of God. Because, you know, if you're like me, sometimes you look around and you go, my goodness, I don't know what to do. You know, I mean, I do, but I don't. And then God will begin to give you some specifics. And believe me, I think through those specifics, we can see some great things happen. Praise God. Nehemiah chapter number 2. Then said I unto them, ye see the distress that we are in, how Jerusalem lieth waste, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Come and let us build up the wall of Jerusalem, that we be no more reproach. You got to understand, one of the reasons why kings would come and conquer people is that they weren't just interested in doing a physical harm to them. They were interested in getting into their psyche, literally. And that's why a lot of times what they would do is when they would come in and defeat a city, they would leave it in ruins for years. And you want to know why? Because it was an intimidating factor. And believe me, folks, that kind of stuff works. There might be somebody here right here tonight that maybe your life's in a little bit of ruin. But I'm here to tell you, God doesn't want to leave it that way. And that sometimes can be a daily reminder that we need to get rid of. But all of a sudden, when we start to let the ruler of all, the rulership of Almighty God come into our lives, God will begin to set order. He will begin to give us things to do that will bring what I call real true restoration. And if we will follow the plan of God and continually follow the plan of God, I believe we are going to see some great things happen, not only with our own personal life, because believe me, folks, that's where it begins. That's not where it ends. That's where it begins. When God begins to do something for you, he has it intended that he wants to show other people that he can do it for them. And that's where I believe sometimes the church in America really stops, is that all we want is God to do something for us. But we got a world out there, praise God, that they're not stupid. They can begin to see when people find good stuff in their life and order begins to be restored. And I'm going to tell you something, the hungry and the thirsty are going to begin to come out of the woodwork and want to know about that in Jesus' name. It's just that simple, praise God. And so here's Nehemiah, praise God, in chapter number 2, and said unto them, you see the distress, you see what's happening here, but let's do something about it. Let's get working on these walls, praise God. Let's get some unity in the picture, praise God. And I believe that God can begin to do something like that, even right here in this church. Amen. Praise God. We do not have the power, it says there, in and of ourselves to bring lasting solutions. Somebody say amen to that. We don't have the power to heal people physically, emotional, or spiritual. You know, the only way that they're going to get healed is the same way that we do, and that is by the power of God. And so we become the mail people. We become the people that can deliver the mail. We become the witnesses in this world that God is still moving amongst his people in Jesus' name. Are you glad about that? Come on, why don't you raise at least one of those hands right now and take a deep breath. Thank the Lord for where you're at, praise God. I'm telling you, if it wasn't for the power of God, none of us would have any hope. None of us would. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The power of God, that's what does it. Amen. And I know I'm going a little bit slow here, but you can read this for yourself. The second chapter of the book of Nehemiah is a very, very inspirational chapter for me. I mean, people got together, they started getting to work, and boy, immediately they begin to see some results. And I mean to tell you, that's important. It really is. Then I told them of the hand of my God, which was good upon me, as also the king's word that he had spoken unto me. Praise God. Nehemiah is beginning to relate what God is saying to him. And he says, and they said, let us rise up and build. So they strengthened their hands for to do good work. Praise God. And so it was just a simple process. What needs to be done? The city needs to be restored. What's one of the first things that need to happen? Is we need to begin to construct that wall that protects us. See, you got to understand, back then, enemies were all over the place. And if an enemy would come into that city and see the walls down, it was easy pickings. It wouldn't take probably 15 or 20 men to go in there and to conquer that city. But believe me, it's like anything else. You know, what did somebody, I heard a commercial advertisement about this, about security. And they said that on an average, that a person that will try to break into a home, they will try that for 30 seconds. And if they fail or they can't get into the house in 30 seconds, on an average, they're going to leave. And so that's why I believe, praise God, that God will help us to construct some things in our life. No, we're not going to keep things completely away from ourselves, but I believe that God can help us to put some walls and some security into our lives that will fend off some of the easy pickings. And in my opinion, this is just my opinion, this is what we need to be teaching our children, that there are certain things that God can put into their lives that won't keep everything away. But boy, will it keep it at bay. And so consider that for your own life. Consider where you are with God. Do you have some protection? Does God really have the ability, or he has the ability, but does God have the access to convict you when things are starting to go a little bit south? Give him that access again, please. You know, I'm not going to beg you to do it. I'm just going to say, hey, it's there for you to have. The first opposition that Nehemiah faced came in the form of discouragement. You know, we just read that in the fourth chapter. Remember that when old Sanballat comes along and he's got his army, right? He's got his army with him. But you notice that Sanballat didn't attack. And you want to know why? Because they were building the walls. See, when Sanballat finally came with his army, they'd already been in construction duty for a few days. And so you must understand, you know, this is what God wants from us. He wants us to go to work, praise God, and construct some things. A lot of times this is going to ward off the enemy just like that. I'm not saying completely, but I'm saying it can to a certain degree. And so discouragement is going to come. Is this really work? I mean, this idea of coming to church and praying, you know, and being obedient to the things of God, is this really working? Well, I'm going to tell you something. You and I must understand we're going to have to rise above the challenge of discouragement. Because believe me, folks, we live in a world that easily gets discouraged. And then they want to, you know, they want to thwart the plan and they want to do something else. No, what you and I need to do is we need to kick the plan into high gear when that comes. Come on, I believe we need to keep doing the things that want to come. Come on, I've been a pastor now for over 30 years. And that doesn't make me an expert, but it makes me somebody who has observed a lot. And I want to tell you, one of the things that the devil, well, not even the devil, people will do sometimes is try to get people away from coming to church, try to get them away from coming to the very things that God has that will bring real, true encouragement into their life. Has anybody, by the showing of your hand, ever experienced that? Well, come on. Well, what's the answer? The answer is not to give in to that. The answer is to say, hey, listen, that's not going to work on me anymore. You're not going to keep me away from church. I'm going to keep coming to church. I'm going to keep going to that prayer room. I'm going to keep fasting. I'm going to keep doing the things that God wants me to do. Come on, folks, it is not that complicated. A lot of times God will give us work to do. He will give us a work to do, if I can put it that way. And then there's never a time when he tells us not to keep doing it. We're the ones that come up with that one. Well, I've been living for God now for 10, 15 years now. I guess it's time to kick my heels up and say, hey, take it easy. No, that's not what the plan of God is. The plan of God is to keep doing what God shares with us and tells us to do. It's just that simple. And in my opinion, that's what happened to Nehemiah. You know, some of those guys that couldn't pound a nail in straight, some of those guys that couldn't, I mean, they'd never gotten their hands dirty to that degree. I believe by the second week, man, those people were starting to get a little bit pretty good at what they were doing. Come on, you got to understand, practice does not, it doesn't all the time make perfect, but boy, it helps it to go a lot better. And if you'll begin to practice the things of God in your life in that practical sense, I'm going to tell you something, you're not going to become perfect, but you're going to become pretty good at what you do. Come on, the old devil or some you know, discouragement comes around your house, you're not going to let that knock you down just as simple as it used to. You're going to begin to turn that radio off and say, listen, I don't need to listen to that report. I'm going to turn on the Bible. I'm going to get some kind of a spiritual song going in this house, and I'm going to begin to listen to what God has to say. Come on, I'm telling you, folks, I know this is very, very practical, but it's the truth. Discouragement is going to come, folks. You and I are going to see it. And we read this before, but it came to pass that when Sanballat, somebody say Sanballat, he's usually the bringer of discouragement. Praise God. That's what he's going to do. You know, look at what they're doing. They're building, praise God, you know. And so he mocked them. He was making fun of them. Come on, the Bible says we can expect that type of a challenge in our life. Come on, we can expect that kind of a challenge because what God intends it to do is to make us stronger. Come on, and this is what the book of Nehemiah teaches us. If we'll just start with the thought of God and seek his face and then begin to get organized and realize that God is going to speak through a leader, and if we'll begin to follow that leadership, I'm talking about godly leadership, we're going to be able to accomplish the things that God wants to see accomplished, not only in our personal lives, but we're going to see many, many people that are going to come and take him up on the same offer. Come on, I believe that in Jesus' name. I believe that God wants to help us. And so Sanballat came, and he was a discourager. Now Tobiah, he was his right-hand man, and he was with him too, and he began to make those stories up. My goodness, that wall wouldn't be able to withstand anything. Well, it did, praise God. It did. And the reason of it was is because there was organized, God-fearing people that were putting that wall up. And so I thank God for that, praise God. I hope this is helping somebody. Well, I'm not hoping. I'm believing this is helping somebody. You might have a personal wall or a gate that needs to come back into the picture. I don't have time tonight, maybe at a later lesson. I think I've done this before, but I think there were like 9 different gates that had to be restored to that city. And every one of them had significance. God is a very organized God, praise God. He's got things in our life that need to have safeguards. Amen. We go ahead and knock on the door, but man, check out who the person is that is knocking on your door. That's what I like about gates. You know, I made this reference before. A fascination that I have in this city, I've said this before, is down at that Chinese restaurant down near the Great Wall. They won't do it for me. Every time I go in there, I say, you need to give me that picture. They ask me every time, what do you want? I said, I want that picture. I don't want egg rolls. I don't need your soup. I don't need whatever else. I mean, I'm hungry and that type of thing. No, I want that picture. That's the one I want. And it's a picture on the wall that you'll see of the Chinese wall that was built. And you talk about, man, inspirational to me. Now, I understand, you know, that it's not as godly as the Bible, but it talks to me. Every time I go in there, I think those guys did not have an easy job of building that wall. They didn't just put that on a straight line somewhere and just, you know, have all of the parts come out the assembly line. It took them a while to build that wall. And that wall was for a good purpose. It was to keep the enemy out. But do you realize after that wall was completed, in the first 100 years, they were invaded 3 different times? And the enemy never knocked down that wall. You know what he did? He bribed a gatekeeper. I'm serious. You can study the history books. That's what happened. A gatekeeper was able to be bribed. And so I understand building the walls isn't the complete project, but it will tell the world that you stand for something. It'll tell the people that you're involved with in your personal life, hey, I stand for something. That's why I believe in outward holiness. I believe that God a lot of times will help us to establish a wall in our lives by what we look like when we go into public. And I'm not saying it's a cure-all, because that doesn't protect your brain sometimes. But I'm going to tell you what it does is a lot of times it'll send a message to the enemy saying, listen, these people mean what they say, praise God. And so think about that. Contemplate these things. Sometimes people are so busy at tearing down a wall before they figure out why it was built in the first place. I mean, that's true. Our world and our generation and our culture has done that. Just get rid of it. We just want it easy. We want everybody to get along. And do you realize, folks, that is a challenge that is never going to happen. And so the best thing you and I can do is just satisfy, or not satisfy, but get ourselves right with God. And stay right with Him. Come on. God wants to help somebody here tonight to develop what I call a Nehemiah spirit. Praise God. Bible says in that same fourth chapter, and Judah said, now this is Nehemiah's right-hand guy. It says, the strength of the bearers of the burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish, so that we are not able to build the wall. This is somebody that's going to go to work for Nehemiah. Kind of needs a pep talk, doesn't he? Come on, you ever found some discouragement in the church? Well, I'll guarantee you're not going to cure it by adding discouragement to it. Amen. So think about that one, praise God. Nehemiah 4:6, it says, so build we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to work, praise God. Once you get people into that mind frame and begin to show them and help them to see that there's going to be accomplishment, oh, I mean to tell you, that can do a lot of things for a project. That can do a lot of things for a project. Can somebody say amen? Praise God. Amen. The second opposition, and there were three of these. First one was what? What was the first one? Discouragement. Okay, I hope you wrote that down, because that is a challenge, folks. God is not going to take discouragement away from this world. He's going to expect you to be able to combat it. Okay, the second opposition that came to Nehemiah was that in a threat of attack. I told you that. Sanballat came with the army. He was ready to run these people over. But if you study the scriptures, you're going to find out that Nehemiah armed his people also. You know, one of the things that you'll find in the book of Nehemiah is the fact that they got to a place where they were working, and they weren't working just 8-hour shifts, folks. Bible says they worked early in the morning until the stars came out at night. And so you got to understand, they were putting in some pretty long days. In fact, the Bible says they didn't take their clothes off. I don't know how spiritual this is, but they didn't take their clothes. Well, I guess that's real spiritual. They didn't take their clothes off. But the Bible says they didn't take their clothes off until they needed to wash them. I mean, they went to busy doing that task. They didn't let anything else get in the way. The reason they were able to raise those walls in 50-some days is because they stuck to it. And I'm here to tell you that there's somebody in here that might be the very antidote for your life. Just stick with it. Put some hard work into it and realize, praise God, that God is going to be there to help you. Our culture wants everything easy, especially in the kingdom of God. And there are some things that aren't going to be easy, but they're going to be worth it. Somebody give me a healthy amen. It's the truth anyway, folks. And so Nehemiah armed his people. And boy, when Sanballat rode up, you know, on the horizon, he saw that this wasn't going to be easy to do. And I believe that sometimes the enemy, our challenge, the devil, needs to see that in our life. He needs to see that, listen, if you mess with those Pentecostals, those apostolics, you're in for a real fight, praise God. And listen to me, that spirit of discouragement I sent over to them the other night, my goodness, that didn't last 5 minutes. They began to pray, and the spirit of the Lord began to fall in that place, and my goodness, they chased us out of there just the way it should be, in Jesus' name. Come on, I'm not making this stuff up. This actually happens. Come on, God wants to help us to be armed. Amen. And so Nehemiah armed his people, and that was his role. That's what I'm doing here tonight, by the way. I'm telling you that you can put some things on of the Lord that will help you in the battle, praise God. Now, I can't make you do that, but I can certainly show you that it can in Jesus' name, praise God. And so the final opposition came in the form of a supposed collaboration. We looked that word up last night. What was that, Sister Carney? Remember what that meant? It means to work together. You see, if the devil can't discourage you, if he can't attack you, then a lot of times what he says, well, let's just work together. Let's just join the rest of them. Let's just get together, and we'll all be in one. And we got to understand, folks, sometimes that's not the role that God calls us to be in. I'm not saying don't try to reach people. But my Bible teaches me, and it taught me very well in my first few years, has come out from among them. I'm talking about people who do not believe the doctrine the way that you and I. See, I believe one of the doors that God will put on our building is the door of doctrine. And boy, once you start asking people, well, what does the Bible say about that? Yeah, you better study the scriptures more than once or twice a year. But believe me, if you start beginning to have that word of God become familiar to you, you're going to have an answer to them that ask of the hope that's in you. And I believe that's what God wants to do. He wants to not only arm us with his word, but with his spirit and with his weapons, praise God. Can you say amen? He will do that, praise God. We don't need to be joining any forces in this world. We need to be joining forces together as a church. And that doesn't mean us four and no more. It just simply means, praise God, that God has unity for us in his church. And this is what he wants to do. That's why I'm saying we need to start working some things out amongst ourselves. And God will help us to do that. I believe he will. The Bible says in Nehemiah chapter number 6, then Sanballat and Geshem sent unto me, saying, come, let us meet together in some one of the villages in the plain of Ono. But they thought to do me mischief. You know what they wanted to do? They wanted to get rid of the leader. That's exactly what they were plotting to do. You study it for yourself. But Nehemiah, through the wisdom of God, recognized that. And he said, listen, I got work to do, folks. I don't have time to get off of this wall. We're going to get it completed in Jesus' name. What a beautiful story, folks. I don't know what this is doing for you, but it gives me an illustration. I picture myself on that wall. I picture people coming up and saying, listen, why don't we do this or why don't we get together with that? And I'm thinking, no, God, you gave me a task, and that task is to get this wall up and to finish it, and nothing else is going to distract me. Come on, am I the only one, praise God, that can see things like that? I can see things like that in a lot of people's lives. Is that what's happening today in the internet or all of the media and that stuff? It's just getting us off a track, praise God. And we need to stay the course. Come on, the Bible says, go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel to how many? Everybody. Come on, this is what the church needs to be doing. We need to be teaching Bible studies, not becoming political advisors. Come on, we need to become people that know what God can do for people no matter what the climate is. Amen. I don't care if the Dow Jones is down or if it's up. My God is still on the throne. Come on, folks. He wants to save people. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. The devil tries especially hard to lure leadership away because he knows the church often rises and falls simply on leadership. That's the truth, folks. There's no question about that, that he tries to lure people away, praise God. And that's what he will do, and that's what he will try. And that's why we've got to stay in the trenches, praise God. And that's why what I would advise for you is pray for your leaders. I know I'm not a perfect person. My goodness, you don't have to explain that one to me. But listen, folks, I'm going to tell you something. I'm somebody who is sometimes not susceptible, but I have those things in my life. Where things will come. But I'm going to tell you something. With the help of the Lord, we're going to rise up above those challenges. Can somebody say amen? What do you say we stand tonight in unity? Let's stand tonight. And let's ask the Lord to help us to have the spirit of Nehemiah. Come on, can God speak to you about a private project? Can he speak to you about a church project? I'm going to tell you something. I believe that just like a Barnabas, we need to have the spirit of Barnabas that knows how to encourage people. I believe we need the spirit of Nehemiah that teaches us to go to work, praise God, that we're not afraid to do something. We're not afraid to get our hands dirty for the kingdom of God. Come on, folks, I believe that God wants to initiate that in this church. Oh, in the name of Jesus, help us tonight, Lord God. I believe that your word has told us many, many things here tonight in Jesus' name. Strengthen us, oh God. Strengthen us in this task, Lord Jesus. Help us not to be easily distracted. Help us tonight. In the name of Jesus, help us tonight, Lord God. Oh, to put off some of this worldly things, Lord God, and to put on the mind of Christ, to put on the mind of Christ in Jesus' name. That's it, Lord God. We call upon you. Nehemiah, his first task was to call upon the Lord. His first task was to go back to Moses, who wrote the law, and say, hey, how'd you have it done then? Come on, come on. I believe that God's got an original task for us. Come on, believe God and do his commandments. This is the whole duty of man. Come on, this is what the Bible teaches us over and over and over again. I take away that spirit of distraction right now in Jesus' name. I come against those seducing spirits, Lord God, that would try to influence in the home. Right now, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, strengthen this body. Help them, Lord God, in where they're at right now. In the name of Jesus. Oh, I do, Lord. I see that right now. Oh, I see that right now in this place. You're rising somebody up right now. You're helping us, Lord God, to see these things for what they're worth. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let's do something here tonight. Let's do something before we leave. I do this a lot, folks, and it's not a ritual. It's of God. Let's minister to one another. If you're near somebody right now where it's proper for you to lay hands on them, go ahead and do that and pray for somebody else. Don't pray for yourself now. Pray for somebody right there, right there, right now, in the name of Jesus. Father, right now, touch these people in Jesus' name. Begin to move upon every one of them, Lord God. Help there to become unity in this place. Not unity of the human mind, but unity of the spirit, unity of the faith, unity of the brethren, Lord God. Let that help right here tonight, in the name of Jesus. I pray that eyes will become open, that ears will become open to the things that God has for them that love him. In the name of Jesus, right here tonight, Lord God, begin to establish these principles. Oh, reestablish them. Let those walls be built. Let those gates be reestablished on our lives in the name of Jesus, Lord God. And I do, I give you the praise and the glory for what you're doing, God. That's it. That's right. Let not one person go out of here discouraged, God. Let not one person go out of here deceived. Let everyone go out of here with a fresh vision of what you're doing in their personal life and what you have in store for the church in the name of Jesus. That's it, Lord God. Help us to make a stand. Help us to put up those walls, Lord God, that will ward off the enemy. Help us to put those gates in so that we can check out everything that comes our way. In the name of Jesus, let everyone here get a visual of that, Lord God, in their own personal life. Oh, I pray for the restoration, Lord God, of your kingdom and your people in the name of Jesus. And I give you the praise. I do, God. I know this is you. It can only happen by the power of God. It can only happen by your anointing. It can only happen, Lord God, as you deem it to be in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. And I do, Lord God, give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. As we do so often in this church, is we try to get what I call good godly apostolic literature. Because, you know, my goodness, from a single pulpit like this or even a number of Bible studies, it just did my heart well tonight. Warren to come into the church tonight, came to church about a little before 6, and back there in one of those Sunday school rooms or teaching rooms, there was a Bible study going on. That's cool. I love that. You know, I don't know if we could ever get enough Bible studies going in this city. And I'm not trying to, you know, be discouraging. I'm just telling you, the more we can fill this city with the doctrine, I mean, the better off we're going to be equipped. And so that has been always a goal for us. Try to get good literature in here so that you can take it home and read it. And we have some brand new Pentecostal Herald. I don't know if you've seen in the last few years. I know we've had it here. But our Pentecostal Herald has become just a tremendous, tremendous tool teaching tool and information tool, and this one here will certainly be of the same flavor. It's called The Armor of God, and in here is about, I don't know, there's probably 10, maybe 12 different articles written by different types of people. I'm not talking about all pastors. This material is not written by just the five full men. It's written by people like some of it's written by people like you that are in churches that had struggles, and God has helped them to overcome that struggle in a certain way. And so if you want to, we've got, I don't know, about a dozen of those copies out there. You're welcome to take one. The only thing I ask you to do is don't throw it in the trash can when you're done. Give it to somebody. Use it. You know, find an article in there that maybe is going to really talk to one of your friends and cut it or make a copy of it. Make a copy. I've done that. Made a copy of that specific article and handed it to the person and said, man, I think this can really help you. I'm telling you, folks, we got all kinds of resources in our hands. You know, we all of us, myself, big time, you know, included, got to get out of our box. And we got to realize that God will give us some things every week if we ask him that we could be handing people and helping them with their walk with God. And so this is just one of those things. Also, you know that, what is this, the 18th? 18th? We're already halfway through the month of January. This is the toughest month to live up here in the Northern Hemisphere, isn't it? Not if you're a snowbird, or not if you're a what would you call somebody who likes snow? Yeah, Karen, that's what she's called. Her first name is Karen, yeah. But you know it is. I mean, it's cold. We've had a little bit of winter here and that type of thing. But warm yourself up and get involved in some prayer and fasting. This is the thing that I feel like is the will of God for all of us. And I'm not going to tell you how to do it. I mean, from the standpoint, I'll give you the principles of Scripture how to do things. But get involved with it yourself. Come on, don't. If you haven't, this is not a reprimand. This is a challenge and an encouragement. We still got, what have we got, 15 days left. And so get involved. Every Saturday, we have concerted prayer here from 5 to 6. I know that not everybody's schedule can be hooked up into a time, but get involved in fasting and prayer. It'll make a difference, praise God. It's designed to do that. That's one of those continuums. It really is. God never is going to tell you to stop doing that. And so you and I got to make up our mind. And sometimes I understand it takes some good godly discipline. Because we get over something, we get through something, and pretty soon we just want to hang around and just hurrah about that. But and God will give us time to do that. But the bottom line is he'll put us right back to work. Because we got a big world out there that needs to be reached. And so consider these things. These are out there in the foyer, and there's actually, if you didn't know this or not, there's some of the older ones out there too. So go ahead and grab one. I'd like to go out there tonight and see every one of them gone. That's just my goal, okay? And so consider doing that, and the Lord bless you. We'll have church again here Sunday, and we're going to have a good time in the house of the Lord. If you want to know what's going on in the month, there's calendars. I know Sister